to the Coders Campus podcast, where you'll learn how to code from one of the best teachers in the industry. Whether you're an absolute beginner or a seasoned pro, the Coders Campus podcast will teach you what you need to know to master the art of programming. And now, your host, Trevor Page.
All right, my fellow coders, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, welcome to the Coders Campus podcast. This is now episode, I believe it's number 21, if I'm not mistaken. So looks like it's episode number 21. So welcome. And today we will be continuing the conversation with respect to the JavaScript language. So in the last episode, we dove into what JavaScript was. We talked about the fact that it was a client-side language, and it has some small parallels with Java, but it is entirely quite different from Java on when you look at the big picture type of thing. So in this episode, I want to get into the deeper reasons as to why Java and JavaScript, although they contain the word Java, why they are quite different. And so therefore, today we're going to be talking about dynamic typing versus static typing. To me, this is one of the big things that differentiates JavaScript from Java, and I'll get into why that is in just a moment. But before I dive into that, I just want to say really quickly that this episode, these new episodes, are essentially brought to you by the new Coders Campus offering that I've put on. Some people have already signed up through the podcast. I'm super excited to have them on board. I'll get into more details of this later, but in case you heard the last episode and forgot to sign up, you can still check it out at coderscampus.com/deal, D-E-A-L. That'll give you 30 days of free access to my entire library of tutorials, which is essentially over 120, I think, 8 hours of tutorials, and it's growing every single week. So check it out, coderscampus.com/deal. All right, so now let's get into, dynamic typing versus static typing. So generally speaking, modern-day programming languages essentially fall into one of those two categories, dynamic versus static typing. And before we can really dive into what dynamic or static typing means, we'll first need to understand what we mean by typing in general. So, really, as a side note, this concept of typing really reaches beyond just JavaScript and Java. So many other languages fall into, like I said, one of these two categories. So it's a much broader subject we're really talking about here. But for in terms of the scope of this conversation that I'm having with you, we're going to be using JavaScript as the example for dynamic typing and Java as the example for static typing. So there's your first little hint. Dynamic typing equals JavaScript. Java equals static typing. Okay, so what is typing? Okay, it's not you hitting the keys on the keyboard necessarily. Essentially, the first place I want to start is to talk a little bit more about the concept of what typing is. So when we say typing, we're referring to the concept of applying a type to a variable. Now, I'm going to go ahead and assume that you are already familiar with a Java language, but if you're not, then hey, I've got a whole podcast that talks about Java. It's called the How to Program with Java podcast. It's back on iTunes. You should check it out if you're not already subscribed to it. It'll go through Java from essentially beginner all the way to expert for free, all yours inside of the pleasure of your own ears will be my voice guiding you through the entire concepts of the Java language. Anyways, let's assume that you already know what Java is. In Java, we're always assigning a type to our variables. So for example, let's say we declare a variable called greeting, and it's going to be a string type. So we say string greeting equals, and then in double quotes we'll say, I don't know, hello or something like that. Or perhaps we want to declare an integer. We say integer, some random integer is the name of the variable, and we set it equal to, I don't know, 100. Or we can have a double. We can have a double, and the variable name would be a double variable, and we can set it equal to something like 2.2. So in all those three cases, and all the variable declarations that we talked about, each of those, essentially we assigned a variable type to each of those variables, right? A string, an integer, and a double. The reason we've done this is because Java is statically typed, and therefore we are forced to assign an exact type to each of the variables before we can actually continue with our programming. Otherwise, we're going to get a compilation error. So having a type is important in programming because it allows the language essentially to decide what to do with your code in certain situations. So for example, if you have two integers and you tell the programming language to add the two integers together, It will add them together just as you would expect. So 2 plus 3, it would come out as 5 because they're integers, right? The language knows to use regular mathematical addition, right? 2 plus 3 is 5, right? However, alternatively, if you had two strings in Java and added them together with a plus symbol, because they are strings and the language knows they're strings, the language then knows to concatenate them and not do a mathematical addition on them. So if you had two strings, 2 and 3, and you add them together, you wouldn't get 5 because they're both strings. So it would concatenate the two. So you get 2 and 3 concatenated would be 2, 3 or 23, depending on how you want to read the string out. So does that make sense? Okay. These types are actually very important. So having said that, the difference between dynamic and static typing is that with dynamic typing, the programmer is not actually required to specify any types for the variables that they create. Okay, I'll say that again. Dynamic typing does not require the programmer to specify a type when they're creating their variable. Now, there's a bit more to it than that. I had a comment on this blog article that I'm sort of, basing this podcast off of. Someone brought up a really good point. He said, let me go down to the comment. He said, apparently, was it Haskell, I think he talked about? Yeah. In Haskell, you don't have to specify a type, and therefore, by my definition, Haskell would be a dynamically typed language, because the programmer doesn't have to specify a type. But everyone agrees that Haskell is actually a statically typed language. So this is where, my definition, applies to most programming languages, but some are a little bit different, because there's a bit more to it, and the reason is that roughly speaking, the distinction between static and dynamic typing follows the distinction between compile time and run time, as well as the programmer assigning a variable type. So what that means is, if you don't have to assign a type, and the type is not known at compile time, the type is only known at run time, then it is a dynamically typed language. Okay? So hopefully that sort of makes sense. So the real world application is this. You don't have to type in an actual variable type, and then if the compiler has no idea what kind of type it should assign to that variable at compile time, then we have a dynamically typed language. But if for some reason the language runs a compiler, goes through the compiler, and the compiler can figure out the type before you run your program, then that is more specifically a statically typed language. Okay, so I know there's a bit more complex than that. Once you really get down into the nitty gritty, it's not too difficult a concept to grasp. But what will help is obviously examples. So let's get into some examples. So what this means is that with languages that use dynamic typing, you don't actually have to decide if the variable you're creating should be something like a double or a float or a string or an integer. You don't have to decide as the programmer. All you need to do is just tell the language that you want to create a variable, and then you go about your business assigning whatever values you want to assign to that variable. Okay, so let's sort of recreate the declaration that I talked about with the Java variables. Remember the three Java variables? We had a string, an integer, and a double. Okay, so there was a string greeting, it was an integer called some random integer, and it was a double called a double variable. Okay, those are the three variables, a string, an integer, and a double. So if we recreate those declarations using the JavaScript syntax and using the fact that JavaScript is a dynamically typed language, you can create them as follows. So instead of saying string greeting equals hello in quotes, you say var greeting equals hello in quotes. Okay, and with JavaScript, in terms of syntax, you can actually use either double quotes or single quotes. It's actually okay to use single quotes when you're talking about strings in JavaScript. But the point there is I didn't have to say string greeting. I just said var greeting. Okay? And this is oftentimes something I get caught up with, because I will often type in string or something like that in JavaScript. I will assign a type because I'm so used to assigning a type, and then everything goes awry and it doesn't like that, and the program won't compile or won't run properly, and then I'm like, what's going on? What's the problem? And then I realize, oh, that's right, you can't assign a type in JavaScript. You have to say var. So you change it to var keyword, and then you're all good to go. So again, moving on to the integer, you'd call it var some random integer equals 100. Okay, again, with your semicolons. JavaScript still uses those semicolons like Java does. And then with the double, you can say var a double variable equals 2.2, for example, and then semicolon. So the point here is that we didn't say string, integer, and double. We said var, var, and var. So when we execute this code in JavaScript, the JavaScript interpreter, also known as the JavaScript engine, will look at the values that are being assigned to the variables, okay, that you've declared, and decide for itself what type should be sort of tacked on or assigned to the variable sort of in the back end when the program is running. Again, important that it's when the program is not running, or when the program is running, not at compile time. Because if it did this at compile time and can figure out the type of the variables, then we would have a statically typed language. That distinction is coming in again, thanks to the wonderful comment from one of the people on my blog. So, again, when we execute the code, the JavaScript engine will look at the values that are being assigned and decide for itself what type to assign to those variables. So JavaScript, the JavaScript engine handles the process of assigning a type to that variable. So having said that, it's very important to understand that just because you didn't have to assign types to your variables doesn't mean that that JavaScript doesn't have types. Okay, some people might think, oh, JavaScript doesn't have types because we don't assign any types to our variables. That's a false statement because JavaScript definitely does have types. Okay, they're just figured out in the back end, sort of inside of the programming language itself. You never have to really expose yourself to it unless you really want to. And maybe I'll talk about the keyword called type of. It's an operator. Maybe I can talk about that in a few episodes from now. It's actually used to determine what type is assigned to your variable, so you can actually check and see if a variable is a string or an integer or what have you. You can use a type of. It's kind of like instance of in Java. It's sort of a similar functionality. Now, before I go further, like I said in the last episode, you can actually get an entire course on JavaScript. So if you're not exactly following along with the podcast, if you need a bit more help and assistance, I have an entire JavaScript course, and it's part of what I call my Coders Campus package, my Coders Campus membership community. Okay, inside of Coders Campus, you get access to every single course I've ever created. Right now, it's at 15 courses, and that number grows pretty much every month or two. Okay, because I add new videos every single week, typically on Tuesdays. So you get access to, like I said, over 128 hours of video tutorials at this moment, plus assignments, plus tests, plus exercise files, plus access to a private Facebook community where you can get in there, ask questions, and get help from yours truly, myself, Trevor Page, or anybody else inside of the community. If I were to go right now and find out, again, this is not... You know, this is only helpful for people who are listening to this episode close to when it's published. But if I were to go and find out how many people I have in the community right now, it's actually over 900 members we have in the community. 900 people are in there and you know, asking questions and getting answers from their fellow community members, their fellow programmers. Okay, so it's a very active community. Like I said, I'm in there as well. I help people out if they have any questions. And this is not to mention all part of the Coders Campus membership platform, which gives you access to every single course I've ever made, one of which is a course on JavaScript. And the cool part of this is you can get access to everything for free for 30 days, and then it's just 10 bucks a month after that. 10 bucks a month. That's like Netflix for coders is what I call it. It's a perfect analogy. So, or you could even get it even cheaper if you really want to, you know, dedicate yourself to coding. You can actually get it as cheap as about $8 a month if you sign up for a full year ahead of time. Okay, so you can actually sign up for a full year for just $97 for the full year, which works out to be about $8 a month. So if you have $100 lying around, which probably most of you should if you are someone who wants to be able to invest in their education. Education is the best place to put your money, ladies and gentlemen. But obviously, I'm a little bit biased in saying that, but I think it's absolutely true. I spend tons of money on education on a monthly basis. So, yeah, you can get access to everything for free for 30 days. Try it out. If you like it, cool. You can stay subscribed, and then you'll be billed either the $97 for the year or $10 per month, whichever you decide. And if you don't like it, you can cancel at any time. You can cancel inside of the trial period, so you won't even be charged a dime, and you can cancel. That's fine. Or if you're, you know, in the monthly subscription and you decide to cancel after 1 month or 2 months or 3 months, you can go ahead and do that. And, you know, it's completely up to you. But at $10 a month, I think this is probably one of the most compelling courses or offers you'll find on the internet today, just because it is such a massive library of tutorials focused on teaching you how to become a full stack programmer. Okay, this is from front end to back end, which is why JavaScript fits into the front end of this equation. So coderscampus.com/deal. Check it out, DEAL. You can sign up today and get access to all of those goodies. All right, cool. So now let me scroll back up to where I left off in our dynamic typing conversation with JavaScript. So I want to talk about how dynamic typing works in JavaScript. So the concept behind how it works in JavaScript is actually fairly straightforward. Like I said, the JavaScript engine will choose a type that it feels best describes the data that's contained inside of your variable. So essentially, when you create a variable and assign a value to it, for example, if you assign a value of hello there in double quotes, the JavaScript engine will realize that this is a string. Okay, and it will assign that as the data type behind the scenes. Because if you put double quotes in any programming language, well, I shouldn't say any programming language because who knows, but in most modern programming languages that I know of, double quotes means a string. Okay, so if you use something in double quotes and say this variable equals something in double quotes, the JavaScript engine will say, oh, that's a string, so I'm going to assign it as a string in the back end, even though you only have to type in var. Like I said, when you declared that variable, you just said var. You didn't say string, you said var. The JavaScript engine figures out it's a string in, you know, its own algorithm in the back end. So this means that if the JavaScript engine has chosen a string data type in the back end and you were to add another string to that variable, it would know to perform string concatenation and not addition, just like we talked about before. So if you had like a 2 in quotes and a 3 in quotes and those were both assigned to different variables, so 2 in quotes was called, I don't know, 2TWO as a variable, so var TWO equals 2 in quotes, the number 2. And then, you know, THREE, so var THREE, which is 3 written out, equals 3, the number 3 in quotes. And you added those two together, you would get string concatenation, even though you didn't ever say they were strings. You said var. Cool? So, yeah, it would just know to do that, and that's really awesome. So all of the sort of same rules of variables that you're familiar with still apply here. There's just an algorithm that works out, like I said, on your behalf, how to assign the type to the variables that you have declared. So we'll go sort of more into detail about what implications dynamic typing has to your coding, probably maybe in 2 or 3 weeks or so, when we dive further into JavaScript variables, okay? Probably next week, we're going to be going a little bit off topic in terms of the JavaScript topic. I think I'm going to be talking a little bit about Spring, because Spring 5 is coming out soon. So I believe next week we'll be talking about that. But anyway, to sort of summarize what we've talked about today in terms of JavaScript, like I said, if you came from a Java background as a Java programmer, it might be a little bit odd of a transition into a dynamically typed language like JavaScript. It certainly was for me. But the most important thing you need to remember is that there are still types that back all your variables. Okay, this is not some Wild West, you know, crazy, no rules, you know, anything goes kind of language. There are rules in the back end. It's just you are not in charge of assigning the types. So you just need to sit back and enjoy sort of your newfound freedom of not having to think about what types are being assigned to your variables when you declare them. Okay, just declare them as vars and walk away. Cool. So that is essentially the beauty of the JavaScript engine. So like I said, if you said var, you know, an integer equals number 1, then it knows to assign that as an integer in the background, even though you didn't type in the word integer, when you actually were declaring the variable. You just said var. So hopefully, like I said, every time I record one of these episodes, I'm hoping that you're screaming at me saying, oh my God, Trevor, I get it. Stop saying that. And if you are saying that, and if you are annoyed by the fact that I keep repeating myself and you understand it, that means, hey, I've done my job perfectly well. I've done exactly what I wanted to set out to do, which is to teach you the difference between dynamic typing and static typing. Cool? So, awesome. Like I said before, also Coders Campus, I know I just mentioned it, you know, in the last 5 minutes ago, but again, we're closing out the episode now. So please do check out coderscampus.com/deal, DEAL, sign up for Coders Campus. Again, free for 30 days. Then it's just $10 a month or $8 a month if you sign up for a full year up front. That is what helps to support the podcast. That is what keeps me recording these podcast episodes, as well as obviously leaving a rating review in iTunes. That also helps the podcast tremendously. So there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining me today. And I can't wait to see you guys next week, where I think we're going to be, like I said, changing the topic a little bit to talk a little bit more about the Spring 5 release, which is going to bring in some cool stuff. But then we'll probably be going back to JavaScript again in the following week after that. So can't wait to see you then. Take care of yourself, my fellow coder. As always, happy learning. Take care of yourself, and bye for now.
Thanks for listening to this episode of the Coders Campus podcast. But before you go, Trevor has a favor to ask you. In order to keep these episodes free, he'd love for you to leave a rating and review the podcast on iTunes. Just go to coderscampus.com/review to leave your own rating and review of the show. So if you have 30 seconds to spare right now, please help out by leaving a rating and review via coderscampus.com/review. It will ensure that you continue to get these awesome free podcast episodes each and every week. So if you like free swag, head on over to coderscampus.com/review. Happy learning!